Let me welcome you to the next session. I'm Dane Borges. I'm a professor of history at the university and director of the Center for Latin American Studies. And it's our pleasure to have you here today. The next talk is on natural gas in Bolivia, resource curse or development boom. And we'll be hearing from Bret Gustafson. Mr. Gustafson got his PhD in social anthropology at Harvard University in 2002. He's currently Associate Professor of Anthropology at Washington University, St. Louis. And as an anthropologist, he's somewhat unusual in focusing on politics. That is, he brings into our discussion of politics not only the sorts of perspectives that a political scientist might have, a high state politics, but an interest in the role of social movements and how they work politically, especially in countries that are deeply divided by race and by language. So he's the author of New Languages of the State, Indigenous Resurgence and the Politics of Knowledge in Bolivia, published by Duke University Press in 2009, which is a study of Guarani Indian social movements and Bolivia's comprehensive 1994 school reform. This reform included what the government projected as a very progressive project of bilingual intercultural education. Basically, this meant teaching children to read first in their own language and then introducing them to Spanish, to school in Spanish. But it meant much more. In Bolivia, the bilingual intercultural education became a kind of touchstone of how people could talk about racism. In a country, probably of all the countries in Latin America, Bolivia was more like Jim Crow Mississippi than any other. And so it still has a politics around education and opposition to kids getting schooling that's reminiscent of the Deep South in the worst of the age of segregation. His current research, however, is on the politics of natural gas, inequality, and political change in Bolivia. So it's my pleasure to introduce Bret Gustafson.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for the introduction, and thanks to Andy and Steve for the invitation and for organizing this. And I was also very happy to see Professor Ingrafia on the agenda because he's one of the scientists, I don't know how few, but who you can look up to counter what is the sort of dominant story about quote hydrocarbons in the United States and in the world. So a lot of what I say will overlap, and I'll try to draw some connections. I had lots of questions I wanted to ask you too, and maybe I'll get to do that in the course of this talk. And thanks to all of you. My former research and my ongoing interest in education are still there, and I'd salute all of you as educators because I know you're in the midst of a political struggle in this country that's not disconnected from the questions of fossil fuels. The same political forces that are fighting regulation, the Koch brothers, Alec, and so forth, those same political forces are the ones who are also fighting to cut teacher tenure, to sort of impose these draconian reforms on public schooling. So it's not a stretch. My move to natural gas politics wasn't so much of a stretch, but continued an interest in trying to understand the politics of transformation, both in Latin America, where I do my research, but also in the United States, where obviously I live. So I'll try to make some connections between the two. I was a little worried when he said, I don't want you to say natural gas anymore, and I thought, oh shucks, that's in the title of my talk. So, but in any case, it's sort of a standard usage, so I use it here. And the sort of reason I got into it, the proximate reason is that the Guarani indigenous people that I work with for many years struggling to improve education access are also now at the epicenter of a natural gas boom, sort of the equivalent of the Marcellus region in Bolivia, in southeastern Bolivia. I won't say a whole lot about the Guarani indigenous people. I'm going to try to make some larger political points, but I can certainly address that as we go forward. So the original talk was just going to be about Bolivia, but then I realized I'm going to try to broaden this out to talk about Latin America more broadly, and then also to some connections with the United States. Very much entangled with the scenario that was painted by Professor Ingrafia about the political forces that are behind maintaining, not energy independence, but maintaining fossil fuel dependence. And these are very powerful. I'm not a big defender of Obama. I would probably suggest that Obama's hands are largely tied. There's deep, deep political power tied to fossil fuels, both here and abroad. So I'll try to make some points about that. And I didn't get a chance to print out my paper, so I'll be jumping back and forth here between this and that. And we'll see how it goes. And I fell off a bike not too long ago, so I'm also taking some narcotics, and I might be incoherent. One of the things as anthropologists, I'm not a geological scientist or a physicist or anything like that. As a social anthropologist, we're interested in the politics of meaning and what things mean. And a kind of a general argument that I make when I teach about fossil fuels is that science and technology are very important, but they will not get us out of this mess alone. The economists like to say, well, when the market decides it's time to switch to renewables, then the market will lead the way to renewables. That's not true either. Neither science and technology or the market alone will address our problems, which are deeply tied to our cultural and social and political dependence on fossil fuels. And to break that dependence requires a really deep rethinking of our daily lives, the way we live our lives, and a deep rethinking of our politics, which are very much controlled by a very powerful economic interest. So one of the points I try to make to students is that when we shift to thinking about places like Bolivia and Latin America, we also shift into trying to understand the very different meanings of things like natural gas or methane, natural gas, and how those meanings are tied up with a very different kind of politics. And so here in the United States, at my own university, Washington University in St. Louis, in recent months, 2 months ago, I got wrapped up in a student sit-in against one of our board of trustees member who's the CEO of Peabody Coal, the largest coal company in the world, who sits on our university's board and promotes all sorts of nefarious propaganda in defense of continued use of coal. I also appreciated hearing, once again, a scientist say that fracking is not the way to go. So here in the United States, it's easy for me to take an anti-extractivist position. And here's one of many examples of movements, or join with students to question our universities being in bed with big coal. Which is anti-science, anti-health, and anti-climate. Meanings and politics change when you go to Bolivia. Now, it's much more difficult for me to go to Bolivia and say, you should not be drilling for gas. Bolivia is a relatively poor country. Gas is one of its few resources. And as I'll be saying in this talk, it is seen by the vast majority of Bolivians as one path out of poverty. And the meanings of getting access to gas in your kitchen have everything to do with a Bolivian sense of a right to have modern amenities. We get up every morning and turn on our gas stove and cook our breakfast, and we don't think too much about it. But that's a great luxury for many people in Bolivia, who now, with natural gas development, are getting access to gas in their homes. It used to be women like this would have to take a little canister like the one that you might have under your grill, if you have a gas grill, and they would go wait in long lines to get a canister of gas, take it home, plug it in under their stove, and use it until it runs out, and then have to go refill it. So something as simple as a domestic gas line that we take for granted in the United States is a monumental transformation for poor households in Bolivia. So this is one a big difference. And for someone like me who fights against coal and fracking and so forth here in the States, to go there and say, no, leave the gas in the ground, they would say, well, thank you, gringo, American. You can get on the next plane home. So a very different political and cultural scenario, and I'll try to say why that's the case. And if we go further outside of the cities to the rural area, this is a Guarani village where I spent many months during my field work, which is now being surrounded by gas wellheads like this one. It's not fracking yet, but they're talking about fracking. Life is being deeply transformed. So whereas many urban Bolivians are very happy about having access to natural gas, in the rural areas, their landscapes are being transformed in many of the same ways as we saw in the earlier presentation, with infrastructure, methane flaring, gas flaring, noise, water issues, and so forth. So in Bolivia, this is a rising sight of both aspirations for quote-unquote development, but also new kinds of conflicts emerging around the environment and around human rights, and especially indigenous rights, because as indigenous peoples were sort of marginalized off of, out to the peripheries of the best lands and so forth, and it just so happens that the eastern slope of the Andes, and you can fix my science on this, but the eastern slope of the Andes, the same sort of geological histories that bring up natural gas along the eastern slope of the Rockies and the Gulf of Mexico all the way down through Latin America, that same geological history from millions of years ago means that now the hard-to-get gas and the gas and oil that is left in Latin America is largely in areas of either the Amazon rainforest or the very dry Chaco region of southern Bolivia along that slope, the eastern front of the Andes, which a long time ago used to be connected sort of to what is now the Niger Delta across the Atlantic. So we're gonna be shifting what anthropologists call perspectives and positions to think about these different realities from the Latin American and Bolivian perspective and from our own perspective. So the natural gas issue for Bolivia largely revolves around the fact that they have a lot of gas in this southern, southeastern corner of the country. Brazil, an industrial powerhouse, you've been watching the World Cup perhaps, an industrial powerhouse has a large demand for that gas. Argentina to the south also has a demand for that gas. Chile wanted that gas at one point, although I'll say a bit more about what happened to the Chile case in a moment. But over the past 10 to 20 years, Bolivia has been expanding its gas extraction activities. Only about 10% of what they take out of the earth stays in the country. Bolivians still consume very little. 80 to 90% of it is exported. And the revenues from those exports are coming back to the country. And this is generating what many people refer to as a development boom. Lots of money coming into the country from the sale of natural gas to Brazil. Oh, this one hand is not going to be cooperative today. A brief history of natural gas in Bolivia to think about some of the politics of these issues. In the 1980s, we had across Latin America what is commonly referred to as the neoliberal era. Neoliberal is not Howard Dean, or Obama is not all that liberal after all, but it's not liberal in our sense. It basically refers to what we call free market conservatives. So a huge push in Latin America to impose free market policies during the 1980s and 1990s. This unfolded in Bolivia under the leadership of this fellow, Gonzalo Sanchez de Lozada. He now lives in DC. Maybe he's on top of one of these leaking methane. Lots of Bolivians would hope so. They don't like him that much. But during that era, United States, with the backing of the IMF and the World Bank, pushed Bolivia to open up its markets, privatize state-led, state-controlled industries, and to open up natural resources, especially natural gas, to private foreign investment. This is broadly what you might call a privatization agenda or a liberalization agenda in the sense of liberating markets and restricting the role of the state in economic development. It was during this period that the export deals to Brazil and Argentina were signed. That pipeline was built across Brazil to get the gas to Brazil. And this fellow also proposed to export gas to the United States via Chile. This is in the idea that you could do LNG, liquefied natural gas, put it on a boat, compress it, take it to Baja California, regasify it, and sell it to the California market. This was also during the whole Enron debacle and all sorts of other things. That scheme fell apart because this whole transformation faced significant popular opposition in Bolivia. And this is one of the interesting cultural differences in Latin America and the United States. Here we have this sort of religious conviction about private property and the free market. So all these homeowners in Pennsylvania, they can really screw up their environment, but they can also get very rich if they happen to own the mineral rights to their land. No such thing in the rest of the world, not just Latin America. In the rest of the world, the United States is the odd one out. Subsurface resources uniformly belong to the state. There's no such thing as private ownership of what's underground. But here we think that makes sense, that I can buy a piece of land and I can also buy 5,000 feet under the ground, and I can own that as an individual. That's anathema in Bolivia, the idea that one person could own that natural resource. So across Latin America, you have a deeply ingrained sense that natural resources belong to everyone. And when you start talking about privatization, export, bringing in foreign firms, it doesn't take long to get a Latin American, and I'm not stereotyping or trying to generalize here, there are variations, but a deeply felt sense that we're being robbed of something that belongs to everyone. An interesting difference from the United States. So you have phrases like selling out our country. This is a common phrase you hear. This is entreguismo, from entregar, to hand over. You're handing over our national patrimony to foreigners. And another phrase that you see from Mexico to Brazil to Venezuela to Bolivia, gas or oil belongs to the people. In Brazil, they say, o petróleo é nosso. That's our oil. In Bolivia, they say gas is of the people. So this fellow faced a significant uprising in 2003. They didn't want to, I say we, I've been in Bolivia for a long time. I won't speak for the Bolivians, but Bolivians did not want to export the gas through Chile because Chile 100 years ago took Bolivia's access to the sea, and they're still upset about that. So they thought that Bolivia shouldn't be shipping its gas through Chile was one big thing, but there was also a sense that control of gas needed to be nationalized, that the government should take control of gas development for the people, not for these foreign capitalists. The gas war of 2003 erupted into massive street demonstrations, protests, and marches. About 80 people, civilians, unarmed civilians, were killed by the Bolivian military. You see the pipeline being represented by one political cartoonist as a cemetery because of the death during the so-called gas war. That was why this fellow fled to the United States. He's still being sheltered by the United States, but in Bolivia he's seen as a war criminal. A couple of years later, after some turmoil and instability, the fellow on the right was elected president, Evo Morales. He is indigenous. Many people associated his election or equated his election with something akin to the election of Nelson Mandela as president of South Africa. After many hundreds of years of minority white rule in a largely indigenous country, this was a watershed moment in Bolivian history and in Latin American history. He was elected with more a majority in the first round, few presidents, if any. When he was elected, he was the first Latin American president to ever sort of get into office in the first round. You never have majority votes. These things are always negotiated in runoff elections and so forth. But he had broad support, not just from indigenous people, but from non-indigenous middle and upper class Bolivians who also felt deeply that the gas is ours, and we should take control of it. The fellow on the left is his vice president, Alvaro Garcia Linera. He's a former Marxist guerrilla, revolutionary, brilliant Marxist intellectual. And he came to power with Evo in 2005. They were reelected in 2009. They're up for reelection in this October of this year. They will probably get reelected. What did their government propose to do with gas? Well, they said, we're going to nationalize gas. That was the platform he was elected on. A few months after he was elected, in grandiose decree of a new law, the government declared that gas resources were nationalized for all Bolivians. They argued and are carrying out significant redistributive projects with gas resources. I'll say some more about that in a moment. So against the free market ideology that says, we'll let the market do its job and things will trickle down to the poor, the government has taken a larger role in controlling gas money and using it to invest in infrastructure, education, healthcare, roads, schools, and in direct cash transfers to the poor, which may sound like a bad idea, but it's not really socialist. Sarah Palin, Alaska, there are direct transfers. If you're an Alaska citizen, you get a check every year from oil revenues. So not a radical transformation of the economy, certainly not socialist or communist. And in fact, though he's widely criticized by conservative economists and the sort of Washington, D.C. foreign policy circles, it wasn't even really nationalization. He gets attacked from the left. And so you didn't really nationalize. What they actually did was force the foreign companies to come back to the table and renegotiate the contracts. So in every country in the world that exports oil or gas, you sign contracts with foreign firms, the Exxons, the BPs, and so forth, to come into your country. You don't have that technology, you don't have the capital, you say, I want you to extract this oil, we're going to sign a contract, you get X amount, and we get X amount. During the free market period, it was outrageous. The government take was around 10%. It's ludicrous. You're basically handing over wealth to foreign companies. So the renegotiation didn't involve nationalizing, buying or expropriating foreign firms. It involved saying, come back to the table, we're going to re-sign these contracts. And so now some of the massive reserves in southeastern Bolivia with the Brazilian national oil company Petrobras, the government take is upwards of 80%. And you might say, wow, how can they get so much? Well, I'll say a bit more about rents and super rents, but oil and gas is capital intensive at the beginning, but once you've got the well in there and once the oil or the gas is flowing out, it's basically what I'll show in a moment, the Beverly Hillbillies model. It's super rent, meaning not rent like you pay on your apartment, but rent as in excess profit, because you no longer have to invest to produce wealth. It's wealth that is basically producing itself. And anthropologists elsewhere have talked about this sort of magical quality of oil. We have the same sense in our own jargon in the United States, strike it rich. Oh, we got an oil well. This sense, wow. You know, these people up in the Bakken Shales, there's a documentary about the North Dakota. These farmers are now dressing like Hugh Hefner. They have these huge mansions because it's just magical wealth. So, but every country in the world does this, from Iraq to Norway to Nigeria. 60 to 70 to 80% of the take goes to the government, and even the World Bank now says, no, that's the logical thing to do. It's not a radical turn. But you'll see in a moment why Evo is critiqued. So, for Bolivia, and coming back to your kitchen, as an anthropologist, I would like to understand what this means to this woman. Well, it's certainly a convenience. It certainly makes her everyday life easier. But when the government goes and makes a grandiose spectacle of installing new gas lines in homes, they're also imbuing that with a sense that this is Bolivia defending itself against imperialism. The act of turning on your stove is a defiance against imperialist taking of your resources. it goes completely against what I say about gas and coal and oil in my class back here, when we're saying we're destroying our planet. So you see a very different political and cultural meaning to gas in Bolivia. Now, the subtitle of the talk was, is this a development boom or is this a resource curse? So I'll say it's both and neither, and I'll put forth a couple of other ways of thinking about this. But in any case, from one economic standpoint, as far as the flow of money in cash, it is certainly a boom of some sort. So this is a representation in one newspaper article that show a woman in folkloric dress riding a pipeline, woohoo, partying basically because of the amount of money that's now coming in from gas resources. If you look at any sorts of numbers, since gas was nationalized in 2005, increasing over the years, income from gas is transferred to the federal government, but it's also transferred to the provincial or state, what we would call state governments and municipalities in increasing numbers. In some cases, so much money is coming into municipalities and state governments that they don't have the capacity to spend it. They have the capacity to steal it, but they don't have the capacity to spend it in any wise way. And there's still some leftovers from the prior era where producing regions, like the Texas of Bolivia is a department called Tarija, and Tarija is where the gas is, and they get a lot more money than other provinces in the country, even though they have fewer people and less poverty. So it's a kind of a distortion of how money should be spent, but many Bolivians see it as progress nonetheless. This was one of the articles that you may have gotten in your packet. The New York Times had a piece. It's very rare that you'll see even the so-called liberal New York Times say anything positive about the left-leaning governments in Latin America, but they had to recognize that Bolivia has managed its wealth rather pragmatically. They have a better fiscal situation than the United States. As a ratio to GDP, they have more money in the bank than China in foreign reserves. So obviously less in total quantity, but in comparison to the size of their economy, they have a huge piggy bank. And this is a sort of an outgrowth of this, the super rents produced by gas. So if you look at this in terms of monetary flow, you might say, yes, this is a development boom, and no, against all predictions, Evo isn't simply squandering it or stealing it, but they're investing it in social programs and policies and projects, that we might say it's a kind of a development boom. And this is looking in strictly economic terms. Now, the Economist article that I had you read, or you might have read, that I sent out is more critical. The Economist, of course, is a bunch of free market Brits who don't like any state or government activity in any realm of the economy. So they say things like, yeah, it looks good now, but wait till the gas runs out and then the party will be over. Or yeah, it looks good now, but Evo, like Chavez and like Correa in Ecuador, is increasingly centralizing power, and this is corroding politics, and Evo is going to become a kind of a Petro dictator. That story is out there, but nonetheless, even the World Bank is sort of lining up now to sort of bow to Bolivia and say, can we loan you money? Because now Bolivia has money and they want to make money on loans, which is what the bank does. And if you look at some of the figures over the past few years, we see some dramatic transformations. Gross national income, which is the World Bank figures I just got last week, from 2004, $904 per year was your income per year on average, and that's gone up to a little over $2,000. I put the U.S. average up there for comparative purposes to see that they obviously are nowhere near what we have here. Poverty has declined slightly, somewhat. Inequality has also declined somewhat. These are contentious figures, but just to give you an idea, and I just threw up there the CO2 emissions per capita, because when I have conversations about climate change with my Guarani friends who are sitting on top of the gas, aren't becoming rich, But I say, you know, in the United States, we think we should stop burning fossil fuels. And they say, you're crazy. Climate change, your problem. You did it. We didn't do it. So don't tell us to stop drilling gas and stop burning gas. You're the ones who are causing the problem. You're the ones who are consuming too much. And they're right. So even if you look at the average emissions of CO2, now I've got to start thinking about methane, but average emissions of CO2 for Bolivian hasn't really increased that much in the past 6 years, because as I said, they aren't consuming that much of this gas anyway. Most of it's going to Brazil. But you look at an average person in the United States, we emit 17.6 tons of CO2 each per year. So if anyone is causing climate problems, it's the United States and not small countries like Bolivia. Now you're going to think I'm a huge proponent of working for the hydrocarbons industry, but I'm not. But stick with me for a few minutes here. So in some senses, this is a development boom, but now I'll speak as an advocate for Evo Morales. And we like to shift positions in anthropology, so I'm not saying that I'm a blind supporter of Evo Morales, but just for a moment, let's speak in support of Evo Morales, who arguably is at the vanguard of a rising change in Latin America, away from that free market orthodoxy of the 1990s and toward rethinking development itself. So whereas the free market people said, let the markets do their work, wealth will trickle down to the poor. I think one UN research said, well, if wealth is going to trickle down to the poor, then poverty will be eradicated in Bolivia in 200 years. That just doesn't go well with the poor people in Bolivia. And the idea that Evo and his party have is that the state must play an active role in dramatically addressing poverty and poverty reduction. So as I said before, when Evo, here's the president, you can see this garland. This is a traditional Andean custom for any sort of celebration, a wedding, a baptism, any sort of ritual event. You wear flowers, you get confetti. You can see some confetti on the shoulder of his jacket. People pour confetti all over you. There's usually a lot of fireworks and drinking and celebrating. So the turning on of the stove has become both a symbol of anti-imperialist resistance and a kind of a right of the poor to access these amenities of the modern world. And just to give you a sense of how it's talked about, this is the National Oil and Gas Company of Bolivia. But as I said, they didn't take over the production activities, simply renegotiated the contract with foreign firms. But nonetheless, they are speak of men, and they're mostly men in the United States, speak of oil and gas in the United States here. They're saying we're reducing poverty. This is the new discourse of coal. It's an outrageous lie that coal is going to address poverty in the world. You look at the Appalachians and tell me what coal has done for poverty. But in any case, this is Bolivia. Sorry, I'll get distracted. That must be the pills kicking in, or my hatred of King Coal. But we generate jobs, we install domestic gas lines, all of this is true. We triple investments in oil and gas, we increase production of gas liquids. And as I said before, if I read something like this in the United States, I'm very skeptical because it merely represents the propaganda machine of big oil. But I read something like this in Bolivia and I have to say, okay, wait a second, is this possible? Is this true? Can this really be an alternative view of development? So summing up what might be called the development boom, it is a government-led redistributive model. It's not socialism, but the government plays a significant role in redistributing gas wealth. As I said before, they reinvest gas rents into public services, infrastructure, welfare, and so forth. They're still very much dependent on global capital. They have this socialist, calls himself a socialist, former revolutionary, and now embracing the CEO of Repsol, Spain's giant oil company. And you say, what? The CEO of a deeply capitalist project is embracing this socialist leader of Bolivia, you get these weird contradictions. So they're still dependent on global capitalism, but the government has prioritized raising standards of living as a government obligation. And one of the things we see this in the constitution that was rewritten after Evo was elected, very different from the United States and very different from the free market constitution of the prior era. The constitution guarantees people the right to basic services like energy, water, school, and healthcare is enshrined in the constitution. That's a very different vision from the free market era. And so along with Brazil to some extent, Venezuela to some extent, Ecuador to some extent, Bolivia represents a challenge to that free market model that is still dominant in Colombia, Mexico, Peru, and as I'll say shortly, in Paraguay. So, and Evo, just last week, he hosted the meeting of the G77 plus China. The G77 are the 77 smaller economies of the world, and they've added China in there as a large ally, which sort of counters the G7 plus Brazil, it is now, G8 meetings that are held in Paris. These are the poor countries of the world, and they all got together in Bolivia just last week. And Evo Morales gave a speech, and I'll read you some of his speech just to give you a flavor of how they talk about change. And again, I'm speaking as a sympathetic supporter of Morales for the moment. He said, we need to conceive a vision that is different from the Western development model. We must move from just the sustainable development paradigm to a live well, comprehensive development approach. Living well is a new slogan that they've taken from indigenous phrases for well-being as being the goal of development, not simply growth, well-being or living well, that seeks not only a balance among human beings, but also a balance in harmony with our Mother Earth. You would never hear any politician or economist in the United States invoke Mother Earth. We'll come back to Mother Earth, who's also known as the Pachamama, in a moment. He went on to say, no development model can be sustainable if production destroys Mother Earth as a source of life and our own existence. No economy can be long-lasting if it generates inequalities and exclusions. All reasonable statements, in my opinion. No progress is just and desirable if the well-being of some is at the expense of the exploitation and impoverishment of others. There's the radical coming out. He went on to say, this is also about sovereignty for countries like Bolivia. We must exercise sovereignty over natural resources and strategic areas, meaning utilities, water, electricity, communications. This does not mean isolation from global markets. Rather, it means connecting to those markets to the benefit of our country and not in the benefit of few private owners. Sovereignty over natural resources and strategic areas does not mean preventing foreign capital and technologies from participating. It means subordinating these capital and technology to the needs of each country. Also, very reasonable. And he finally went on to say, and again, defend the notion that people have rights to live well. He said, the worst tyranny faced by humankind is that basic services under the control of multinational corporations. Basic services meaning water, electricity. We're fighting the same French firm that wants to privatize St. Louis's water supply that is similar to the ones of Bolivia we're fighting in 2000 when they fought another war over water privatization. So this is coming to the United States. This practice subjugates humanity to the specific interests and commercial aims of a minority that becomes rich and powerful at the expense of the life and security of other persons. Basic services are inherent to the inhuman condition, to the human condition. How can a human being live without running water, power supply, or communications? This equality can only be realized if access to basic services is universal. Our need for water, just for, as our need for light and communications, makes us all equal. And he goes on to criticize the international debt system. We want to rid ourselves from the international financial yoke by building a new financial system that prioritizes the requirements of the countries of the South. We must replace international financial institutions such as the IMF for other entities that provide for better, broader participation of the countries of the South. And we also need to define limits to the gains from speculation and to the excessive accumulation of wealth. Oh, the Koch brothers are turning over in what will soon be their graves. So these are certainly radical shifts in the discourse away from this free market ideology and toward a different vision of development. I'll skip over some of this because we're short on time, but it goes on to say that the time has come for the nations of the South. We were colonized and enslaved. Our stolen labor built empires in the North. Today, with every step we take for our liberation, these empires grow decadent and begin to crumble. And if you read Bolivian political activists, they're pretty much convinced that the U.S.'s day is coming to an end, and there's a new world emerging. Our liberation is also for the whole of humanity. We are not fighting to dominate anyone. We are fighting to make sure that no one becomes dominated. Only we can save the source of life and society, Mother Earth. Our planet is under a death threat by the greed of predatory and insane capitalism. So by now you may have realized that there's somewhat of a contradiction. Massive expansion of natural gas drilling and extraction, which has all of these environmental consequences and generates social conflict. But a new discourse of development that is talking about a very different way to use those resources to transform people's lives for the better. So that's my Evo Morales hat for the moment. I just want to put that out there for you. I don't want to say this is what's happening or this is going to happen, but just to give you a flavor of the way this transition is being talked about. And now I'll shift quickly to the critique, or two kinds of critique. The first is what the economist says. This is simply another manifestation of what we call the resource curse. If a country is largely dependent on oil, whether it's Saudi Arabia or Iraq or Nigeria or Bolivia, meaning that oil makes up, or gas makes up, a significant percentage of GDP in exports, you create fiscal dependence. Alaska, Louisiana. The government is increasingly dependent on those oil and gas monies to run its operations. A political scientist at Stanford wrote a book on Venezuela, arguing that this erodes the relationship between governors and citizens. There's no incentive to tax, because you just hand out money. And if there's no incentive to tax people, there's no sort of incentive to engage politics as a kind of a contractual relationship between citizens and governor, but you look at it more as a paternal relationship. We have a right to be given this money. So there's an argument to be made that it distorts distorts government. There is corruption. It creates what the economists referred to as rentier logics, meaning that you don't run for mayor because you have an idea about how to make your municipality better. You run for mayor because that's where the money is. And so now you have people getting involved in politics not for ideological reasons, but to get to where the budget is. And because of the money coming into these municipal coffers, you have increasing conflict over access to control of those monies. So the logic of capturing rent starts to dominate the way you think about politics. There's actually a saying in Bolivia that says, Dios no me dé, ponme donde hay, which means, God, don't give it to me, just put me where there is some, meaning give me a job where I have access to money. Increasingly, the argument goes that as governments, and this certainly is the case in Nigeria, Saudi Arabia, Iraq is in a different situation right now, but as governments sort of erode the relationship to the citizenry, they become reliant on using gas monies to maintain themselves in power and tend to spend it on corrupting power to stay in power by increasing support of the military. This is Nigeria, Saudi Arabia. Or buying off political opposition, or creating structures of oligarchic power. You see this with coal in the United States, in certain parts of the United States, especially West Virginia. So as the economist argues, now I'm putting on my right-wing free market hat, this is sort of an illusory development. And it's instead of having government control, you should have the market doing its work so you don't get these corrupting effects on government. And I put up here two examples of the sort of resource curse. One is the Beverly Hillbillies model. Many of you look to be my age or around that, so you remember the Beverly Hillbillies. And that's basically oil. We just get money. We don't have to produce. We don't have to invest. We don't have to work. We just get money, all right? So this is one of the effects of the resource curse, or the Louisiana or Nigeria model: oil, rents, finance, corruption, and private gain. So critics from the right don't see Evo as a savior of the planet. They see him as the next Gaddafi or Chavez or Putin or Ahmadinejad's not there anymore, but these oil tyrants around the world. Okay, so this is a dilemma for Bolivia. Can gas resources be used for another kind of development, or are they simply going down the road of the resource curse? And I put up here this picture, which was in the New York Times yesterday, just to point out that these meanings of gas and oil, as I said before, aren't limited to Bolivia. This is from Mexico, where they're currently fighting a proposal to privatize, to increase private control over Mexican oil development in the Gulf of Mexico, to bring in the Halliburtons and the Schlumbergers, who have offshore technology. And many Mexicans are opposed to this, saying, there's that word entrega again, no to handing over oil to foreigners, no to foreign control of our electrical industry. And so this is a debate that you get across Latin America. And we don't see it yet, although it's curious, you know, we started talking about exporting gas, and the coal people know that we're not going to keep burning coal here, so they want to export it to China. So we're getting a situation where I think Americans really don't have a consciousness of what it's like to say, no, we don't want to export that. Number one, it's bad for the planet. But number two, it's alienating our own resources. But this is deeply felt across Latin America. So drawing some other connections and debates, there's a broader environmentalist debate. So the economists say, well, good growth or bad growth, but it's growth. The environmentalists say, Latin America needs to get off of this extractive industry dependence. So whereas Evo and his government in Bolivia are promoting extraction and saying this is good to address our social problems, critics from the environmental left in Bolivia and elsewhere in Latin America are saying, we need to address, you know, we need to get beyond extractivism. And you see rising conflicts over extractivism, not only in Bolivia, but in Argentina, where you have fracking is unfolding in southern Argentina, oil exploration in Ecuador and protected areas in Ecuador, which are causing significant conflicts with indigenous peoples. And the new frontier of conflict in South America is rising around biofuels. And I'll say a bit more about that. But soy makes biodiesel, not just tofu. And sugar makes biofuels, ethanol, not just sugar. And especially in Brazil and Paraguay, there's a rising landscape of soy and sugar that's taking over much of the southern part of Brazil and Paraguay. And the United States has its eye on that land as the next battleground for fuel. Because when the oil runs out, then we're going to be reliant on growing oil and fuel. And so soy and sugar are big battlegrounds coming in the future. And this is just a picture of a march in defense against a plan to build a highway to get access to a protected area in Bolivia. So even though Evo Morales is indigenous and he talks about helping the poor, he's also facing increasing conflict from some indigenous peoples in Bolivia against extractivism. So, in my final 2 minutes, what does this all have to do with the United States? Now I'll step back into my radical Latin Americanist shoes, and I'll say that the United States has always looked at Latin America as a provider of resources for our economy. And so that if you talk about energy in Latin America, you're talking not only about struggles within countries like Bolivia, but from a Bolivian perspective, you're talking about a struggle with that great monster in the north. I've turned it over so you can sort of think backwards a little bit with me here. And this is how the United States is viewed. And by and large, this is true. This is true. We talked, we used to, during the McCain-Palin era, it was going to be energy independence. It was a lie. It was impossible. I'm glad to hear you reaffirm that today. We're never going to be independent in terms of oil. But they said, well, and then they shifted it. Well, we can be energy independent plus Canada. And who cares? Canada's not really a different country anyway. It's just right over there. But now you're hearing them say, well, we're going to be independent from OPEC in 20 years. And then Obama at one point say, well, we're going to try to reduce dependence on the Middle East, but we're going to be dependent on the Western Hemisphere. So we're looking at Latin America as our source for oil. And Professor Ngrafia sort of listed some of these just last week. These are the top 10, top 12, actually. There are 12 here. I squeezed 12 to get Ecuador into the frame. But a good chunk of our oil, at least from our top 12 importers, comes from Latin America. And we want that to keep flowing to us. We don't want it to go to China. And we want control over that oil. So we don't like governments like Evo, who exert a strong, or Chavez, now Maduro in Venezuela, or Correa, who exert a strong national control over activities. We want it opened up to those companies, who are largely our companies. So we have oil dependence that's ongoing, an ongoing source of conflict. Our politics is very different from Evo politics. We want free trade. We want open markets. We want privatization. We're running out of places for Wall Street to invest, so we want to make money off of electricity production in Mexico or Brazil or Bolivia, or water, or oil and gas. So we don't like government control of that. We want free access. So there's a huge battle between the United States vision, now we're allied with Colombia and Mexico on this, and the vision of countries like Bolivia. The global debt machine. We have a financial crisis. We have so much money, but we have no way to reproduce our capital. So we're looking for places to invest, whether it's fracking or whether it's oil or fracking in Argentina or somewhere else. There's another case in the news these days. Argentina's fighting these vulture funds that are demanding Argentina pay back these exorbitant gains on junk bonds that were bought back during the prior default of Argentina. They're called vulture funds. This is basta buitres. It means enough with the vultures. And vulture funds, hedge funds, investment funds are looking at oil and gas in places like Argentina and saying, we can get money out of this. So we need to open up, keep drilling, keep that money machine going to keep the Wall Street financial machine churning. The United States, despite what we've just heard today, which is that fracking is bad in every sense of the word, the United States State Department even has a pro-fracking initiative to support fracking around the world. If you Google U.S. State Department unconventional something initiative, you'll see how we're trying to promote this. This is largely because, I think, of service company lobbying, because we don't have the oil reserves ourselves, but we have the technology. So we want our companies like Halliburton to be able to sell their fracking technology to places like Argentina, and, of course, the tar sands, and, of course, Brazil's offshore oil. So the more free markets, the more access our companies have. And this is seen as a threat by many Latin Americans. And as I said before, U.S. biofuel interests in the region mean that energy is not just about oil and gas reserves under the ground. Energy is now about land. And you have a global phenomenon called land grabbing, which are large companies grabbing, buying up large chunks of land. I won't go into this, but those red places, that red hole, Paraguay, who declared a state of siege last year, these red markings are places where indigenous leaders in Brazil have been killed because of their trying to stay on their land, which is being handed over to sugar cane for ethanol. These green markings are ethanol mills. So you see a direct correlation between violence against native peoples and the expansion of biofuels. And finally, another one, which I don't have time to explain, but with the rising debate about climate change, the economists on the right, you're right, my right, are saying that we can have a market solution. Gregory Mankiw, conservative economist out of Princeton, I believe, just put an editorial in the New York Times a day or two ago saying it's time for a carbon tax. It's a very conservative solution. It won't address this huge short-term problem we have. But part of carbon tax is the creation of a carbon market, meaning that I can burn carbon here, I can emit carbon here, but if I buy a huge chunk of rainforest in Brazil, I'll offset it. What does that do? That creates a huge market for land that displaces people who might need that land for something else. So energy, again, is seen as a rising threat to land rights in places like Latin America. There's a lot of research emerging on what's called the global land grab. I think my time is up. I'll end it with the most disturbing thing is that all of this is invariably accompanied with the expansion of militarization, which is why we don't like Evo Morales, because he kicked out the DEA and he doesn't want U.S. military troops in Bolivia. That was a lot, I'm sorry.
Thank you. We now have time for some questions to unpack this wonderful presentation.
Sorry, I went over.
Overwhelming or completely incomprehensible?
Yes.
There's a format to this. So not even looking at climate change, how are they handling other environmental issues with this growth?
The worst environmental problems in Bolivia right now are actually tied to mining, which I didn't talk about. The gas development is creating water issues because the region where the gas is a very dry region, and drilling for anything requires a lot of water and pollutes the water that it uses. So that is becoming an increasing issue. But right now, the most environmental problems in Bolivia are tied to mining. And critics of Evo Morales say that they're not doing enough to address that. And the contradiction between instilling the right to services as a human right means that whenever anyone opposes drilling, you're saying you're opposing a fundamental human right. It's the government's obligation to provide gas to these people. How can you oppose drilling? So you're put into a political quandary there. Okay, are you for letting people have access to services, or do you think we should stop drilling? So there's a contradiction and a quandary there. Yeah.
What if anything is the Morales administration doing to encourage non-extractive job growth?
Economy. Yeah, good question. Can it? This is the question. Can it? Can it do anything? So the political rhetoric is we are going to industrialize the gas, or we're going to use gas resources to diversify the economy. That's the ideal. Can it do that? Does it have access to capital and technology to generate a different kind of economy other than an extractive economy? To date, the only thing they have done is to deepen dependence on gas by talking about industrializing it through polyethylene and fertilizers. And where do the fertilizers go? To expand large-scale agro-industry. And plastics, you know, he talks a lot about Mother Earth, but plastics and Mother Earth aren't good friends. So they have a very limited, right now, notion of how to get beyond extractives. In Ecuador, the president is pushing the creation of a technology-based knowledge economy for the day after oil. Venezuela, before Chavez, with Chavez, and now after Chavez, has always grappled with this component of the resource curse. That not only is it hard to diversify an economy that is already dependent on oil, it's hard to think about how you might generate a new niche in the global market. What product will you produce? So the critics on the green left are saying that we need to rethink development not as large-scale industrialization, but as small-scale economies. Small-scale farming, medium-scale farming, these types of economies that are socially sustainable, but may not involve the creation of large factories. But to date, this is a coming dilemma, is how do you employ people in an economy that is not labor intensive? And no hydrocarbon economy, despite what the Koch brothers say, is labor intensive. I think there was another question here.
I think you answered what was on my mind. My question was, why can't we do all of this but have the agenda that we're working towards the betterment of Mother Earth and human nature?
Evo would say we can, and that's what we're doing. His critics, again, well, from the right, they just don't like him and they want him out. But from the left, they're saying, look, you said you were going to do away with the old-style, patriarchal, military-centered politics, and that's what we're seeing return. You said that indigenous peoples would have rights to say, no, we don't want extraction in our territory, and we're not seeing that. It's like oil and gas trumps zoning here. Oil and gas trumps everything in Bolivia and Latin America, or biofuels. So on paper in the Constitution, there are also indigenous rights to land and self-determination, prior consultation, all sorts of ostensive ways to control and or mitigate or benefit from development. But at the end of the day, extraction is the priority right now. And their argument is that in order to defend our political project against the tentacles of the empire, the United States, this is our short-term priority. We must rely on this. And the vision for the future, certainly other kinds of economies, other sorts of development, but what is that? We don't know yet.
I actually have a question about some of the broader geopolitics, and I hope it doesn't unfairly take you too far afield from your own research. But when looking at recent international talks on the environment, on limiting carbon emissions, so on and so forth, sponsored by the likes of the United Nations, there are disputes that really seem to be north-south disputes. Northern countries demanding exceptions from various types of regulation limitations, but demanding them from developing economies, especially the big, you know, China, India, Brazil, but including members of the G77 like Bolivia. And obviously, as you presented today, Evo Morales has been an outspoken proponent on issues of fairness and thinking about North-South inequalities, right, invoking imperial histories and some of those complexities. And so my question is this: if the, in some ways, a problem of finding, if in some ways obstacle to solutions towards responsible use of resources, responsible uses of the environment, are these large geopolitical North-South inequalities, what kind of, have you encountered various murmurs of possible resolutions? Are there ideas out there that are gaining traction? Or does this seem to be a real sticking point that North-South, differing North-South visions of what the future will look like cannot be possibly squared with one another?
Right. Well, I'd love to be optimistic, but until the U.S. and China sit down at the table and take some serious steps, not much will happen on the global scale. I mean, there's a movement for global climate justice, which says we screwed it up, so we need to pay these countries to grapple with it. Bolivia's glaciers are melting, they have water shortages, all sorts of climate effects that they're seeing that the global climate justice movement says the developed countries should be paying for. Will that happen? Ecuador said, we'll leave the oil in the ground in Yasuni National Park if Europe pays us to leave it in the ground. And no one in Europe stepped up to the table. So they say, okay, well, we're going to drill. We have no choice. So, and the current political situation in the United States is such that we can't even get a modest carbon tax through Congress, let alone take a serious steps with China to address these issues. So I think, I think those global Copenhagens and so forth are probably important spaces to produce talk, but, you know, I think the real struggles are on the ground. And that means, for example, in Argentina, there's a growing anti-fracking movement. Brazil, of course, has a vibrant environmental movement. Bolivia is not so much an environmentalist movement, but there's certainly an indigenous rights movement that's saying, let's rethink this. I'm not sure if I'm sort of saying no, I don't think there's a short-term solution to the North-South conflict. But I think if we look at other spaces, and in the United States, definitely, you know, my students, you know, this question of global warming and climate change and coal and so forth, you know, my mom, okay, you think you get older, I get more radical, but my mom's get more conservative. She said, well, you need this Keystone pipeline because they're going to be, you know, we got to have this oil or we're going to keep, it's just, they've just sort of absorbed this oil company discourse. But the students, the hope I have for the United States are the 16 to 30-year-old generation, which is really taking seriously global warming. I mean, you read Rolling Stone magazine, and you're like, okay, they've got it right here. And this is, so student movements, teachers and so forth working, they really need to raise awareness of this, because the oil industry, in the United States case, is actively producing disinformation and confusion. That's their modus operandi. So, So I'm sort of going away from your question about big solutions and saying, no, but let's think more about movements like housewives in Pennsylvania who are fighting fracking, or the students who are fighting coal. I think that's where some hope lies. You know, I don't think it's going to come from the top down. Maybe that's idealistic. 3 minutes.
Narco-capitalism in Bolivia. Is it a fallback position? Is it creeping back in? If you're looking for another way to spend the money,
oh yeah.
If you're looking for an alternative, alternative industry, yeah. Alternative employment, all those small farmers yeah. who got off the coca leaf are now.
Right. Oh, they're still making cocaine. I was just telling Stephen last night that the cocaine economy has been slightly democratized because they figured out the new Colombian method is you can make it in your kitchen with a blender and a washing machine, and you don't need a big lab in the jungle anymore. So you have a kind of a democratization, and critics of Evo say they sort of opened the way to the resurgence of cocaine. So yes, it's still alive and well in Bolivia. No, I don't think it's a narco state. Curiously enough, despite the fact that many politicians in Latin America, including people on the right, have said we should really think about decriminalizing drugs, that Evo has taken this weird position against that. He defends the coca leaf, but they're not promoting the sort of decriminalization of drugs. So I'm not too up on the internal politics of that, but. It certainly exists as a parallel economy in Bolivia, and it sort of brought Evo to power. When the privatizers came in, they shut down all the mines, the nationally owned mines up here in the mountains. A lot of those people, including Evo Morales' parents, migrated to the jungle, started planting the coca leaf. Coca leaf, I've chewed it often. It's not a narcotic. Cocaine is. They planted coca leaf, and Evo grew to political prominence as a leader of coca leaf growers. And he especially got support when the United States started attacking him. And he got elected president, some people say, because the U.S. ambassador said that, I hope Evo Morales doesn't get elected. And just to spite him, everyone voted for him. So is it an alternative economy? You know, could we see a cocaine alternative, diversify Bolivia's economy with cocaine legalization? That would be sort of ludicrous for me to promote that, but unfortunately or not, it still sort of fits that pattern of extractive export. Because the coca, you can make paste, they make paste in Bolivia, and then it's often refined in Brazil, and the money's made in Europe. So just like oil and gas, the industrialization and money is made elsewhere, cocaine is kind of the same kind of product. So, I mean, this is imagining if we were to say. They are making toothpaste, shampoo, soda, and other sorts of things out of the coca leaf. Could that be a large alternative? Probably not, because the United Nations, with our support, continues to criminalize the coca leaf itself, even though it's good for you. That's an interesting question.
Well, let us thank Bret Gustafson.
Thank you. Sorry.